Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Good afternoon, everybody. It is the Steve Jones Show on a Tuesday. Matt Catrillo here with you. Steve will soon be there in the Sunbury Motors Studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. And online at sunburymotors.com. Ford Kia Hyundai, great selection of new and pre-owned inventory. And whether you have the sales staff that is there for you, and not just there for the sale, or the service department that is there for you with the diagnostics, the inspections, all the routine maintenance, it is all part of the Sunbury Motors guarantee one way or the other. And it is something that has helped this SMC community grow more and more, and now because of that, more of those awesome technicians are needed to work in the quick lane car light truck service, heavy truck service, body frame and alignment, and towing departments. So whether you got some experience, you want to look for your first job, or maybe you're just looking for a career change, they'd love to hear from you. Stop by in person, apply online at sunburymotors.com, or you can call Todd at 286-7746. All at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Focusing some more attention to the Steelers today. They, of course, have the Raiders Saturday night in what is the Christmas Eve showdown, and if you can call it that, and of course, remembering the 50th anniversary of the Immaculate Reception. And it just came down today that Kenny Pickett is set to return from his concussion. As of Monday afternoon, he remained in the concussion protocol, but Mike Tomlin said if the team practiced Monday, Pickett would be a full participant. So there you go there. And the wind chill, though, it's going to be frigid if you're making the trip out to Heinz Field Saturday night. Temperatures expected to be around 8 degrees at kickoff. Wind chill estimated to be at minus 4. That's for a lot of games because of this winter weather cold front system storm that's coming through starting in the west and the midwest, and it's going to come to our area a little bit. So there's going to be a lot of NFL games affected one way or the other with either cold temperatures or precipitation. Then there's this with the Eagles today with somewhat of a wrinkle with Jalen Hurts' up-in-the-air status for Saturday's game against Dallas, where Nick Sirianni is not ruling out Jalen Hurts. And then Jalen Hurts himself said he definitely has a chance to play Saturday. Overall, it's one thing for the player to say it. Because, I mean, it's that just player's mentality where they're going to try to play no matter what, even if they're on a stretcher. I mean, that just goes without saying. When it comes to the coach, though, he said he's coming up with a game plan for Jalen Hurts and a game plan with Gardner Minshew, a quarterback. So to me, there's some gamesmanship going on here, which is totally fine. I mean, you're playing your division opponent second time around. There's the familiarity with both teams already. So you had this little wrinkle where you have to prepare for two quarterbacks, and I don't necessarily mind that, Steve, but I would still be floored and a little concerned if Hurts somehow plays on Saturday.
Cowboys have to prepare for two quarterbacks? They have to prepare for one. Okay, the other one is irrelevant. I mean, what does the other one do that the one doesn't do? He didn't do anything different. Okay, he doesn't run. So you don't have to worry about that. You prepare for the one that can do everything, and then you end up with the one that can do less. You don't have to do anything. Prepare for two quarterbacks. You don't have to prepare for Gardner Minshew. Are you kidding me? You're kidding, right?
Well, in terms of there might be some, it's not necessarily Minshew per se, but it's more they're going to be a little bit different looks with him in there, because you're probably not going to run as many RPOs, is what I'm saying, and things like that, like you do with Jalen Hurts.
So in other words, you prepare, my point is you prepare for all the things Hurts does, okay? Because Minshew doesn't do anything, okay? That, in other words, if it were reversed and Minshew were the starter, okay? You would have to, like, okay, we got to prepare for a second style here, because if Minshew can't play and Hurts has to play, yeah, he runs more. So now you have to prepare. In this case, you just prepare for what Hurts does, because if Minshew gets in there, all that other stuff gets pared out, and all the passing stuff is exactly the same. See what I mean?
It's fair. I'm just saying the gamesmanship is there.
What gamesmanship? There is no gamesmanship.
Well, gamesmanship, quote-unquote, is if Sirianni's not really committing to either quarterback.
You're back, yeah, because the other guy, the starter, does, like, all this stuff. So he's making them prepare for all this stuff. The reality is if Minshew plays, you're like going, okay, it's fine. We just have to worry about this. Don't worry about the quarterback draw. It doesn't exist. Don't worry about scrambling around. Doesn't exist. Right? I mean, I'm just being real. Like, you and Mike both got mad at me yesterday. Right? Yeah, and I can tell that, you know what the two of you have in common? I think you guys hate Dallas more than you love the Eagles. And that is, that's little brother syndrome. And and I can tell you right now, I grew up in an area that still has little brother syndrome. Who's been the better team between the Red Sox and the Yankees this century? By a wide margin.
The Red Sox.
Right. And guess who keeps yelling Yankees blank all the time? In the what are you doing that for? You're the better team. Stop acting like little brother. Right? Those are quote my fans. Okay, I get disgusted every time I hear that. You're better. Okay, the Eagles are better than the Cowboys. They're better. Root for the Eagles. Oh, the Cowboys, what do you call them? The Cowgirls, or what do you call them? Like, oh, just, Mike, come on. You're better than that. Your team's the better team. Okay? They're better. And this is, you know, and the Eagles have a golden opportunity in this era right here, this 3-year window. They have a golden opportunity to be the best team in the NFL the next 3 years. Why?
Rookie contract for Jalen Hurts. Yep.
No, it's not a rookie contract for Jalen Hurts. Okay? It's a rookie contract for Jalen Hurts. Okay? Let's clarify that. You totally... Howie Roseman is the executive of the year in the NFL. Why?
Well, for A, what, drafting Hurts, but B, be able to bring all these pieces in that he did the offseason because he's got the second-round contract.
Look, I don't care what Howie Roseman says. He didn't draft Hurts because he thought he'd be this. No offense. Okay? He was a little bit different. I think they were kind of hoping he could be a little bit of a change. Remember, we had Sal Powell on the show.
Fair, yeah.
Remember? Right? He didn't. Okay, so don't. If anybody goes, Howie knew this was going to happen, okay, I'll buy you another drink at the bar. Nobody thought this was going to happen. Nobody, except maybe Jalen Hurts.
But basically, he took advantage of the situation and the flexibility that he had financially because of the second round contract with Jalen Hurts, and he brought in a lot of talent.
Yeah, but he lucked out totally. It's a total luck out job. Completely.
Oh, yeah.
Because right now, Howie Roseman was counting on Carson Wentz being his quarterback this year when he drafted Jalen Hurts.
No question.
He did not draft Jalen Hurts to replace Carson Wentz. I don't care what he says. If he says that, he's lying through his teeth. It's a bald-faced lie. Right? He's kind of hoping he'd be a supplement, a little bit, you know, like a little bit change up. Hey, maybe we can play him, you know, we can play him like a slash role, things like that. That's what people were thinking about when he drafted Jalen Hurts. Well, then he was forced, then they were forced to play Jalen Hurts. Okay, now you're forced to play him. Son of a gun. Guy's doing a great job. And then, son of a gun, I trade Wentz. And son of a gun, Hurts leads us to the playoffs. And I've got all of Indianapolis' draft choices, which was a brilliant. See, that was the brilliance of what Howie did. The brilliance was what he looked at him in the rookie year and went, I think we got something here, to his credit. We'll trade him to Indianapolis, Wentz. He gets the first pick, which then gives him, if Hurts doesn't pan out, this is going back now, he can draft a quarterback.
Correct.
All right? Well, now you want to talk about the eureka of all eureka. He doesn't have to draft a quarterback. Whoa.
And he's got a potential top five pick with New Orleans with the trade he made during the draft this year, too.
Right. So he's got draft capital. He can trade some of it if he wants. Right?
Yep.
Or he can keep it. And because the quarterback that is still on a second round, not a first round rookie contract, a second round rookie contract, he now, why was Snyder such a great GM with Seattle?
Same with Russell Wilson. He was a third round
pick. So that allowed Seattle to do what? They signed that entire secondary, Cam Chancellor, Earl Thomas, Richard Sherman, signed all of them to longer-term contracts and locked them in. They brought in Bobby Averill as a free agent, big pickup, brought in Percy Harvin, who in the regular season didn't pan out, but in the playoffs did. They were able to do all that because they looked around and said, we've got money. Well, look at the Eagles have. They've got money. Because their quarterback is on the cheap. Now, at some point, the bill will come due. And when the bill does come due, I mean, why do you think, for example, Green Bay, everybody talks, hey, they need receivers. Well, one of the reasons is Rodgers eats up a lot of money. It's going to be interesting how what Brett Veach does with Kansas City, because Patrick's going to eat up a lot of money. What will the Bills do? Josh Allen, he's going to eat up a lot of money. And you notice, finally, for once, Brady is finally, now Brady's 45, but Brady was always on the cheap with New England, right? He always took a lot less money along the way, and the Patriots have financial flexibility to make all the moves they want. The Eagles are not only in that spot, but even better, because Howie Roseman was smart about the deals he made for draft choices. The Wentz deal was a stroke of genius. The deal with New Orleans was a stroke of genius, right, on his part. Drafting DeVonta Smith and jumping the Giants. I mean, imagine DeVonta Smith's with the Giants to go with Barkley and Daniel Jones.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, Daniel Jones is no better than an okay quarterback. You watch him. He doesn't, like, if the play is supposed to go here, that's where he goes. He doesn't really do anything else. See, Hurts has outworked everybody. I mean, he has worked so hard to be a quality NFL quarterback. He's outworked everybody. Love watching him play. Right? And they built a really nice team around. The offensive line's terrific. Sanders is terrific. He's a free agent. They're getting Dallas Goedert back this week. Wow. Brown and Smith are, that's as fine a wide receiver combination as there is in the conference. Defensive line's terrific. Reddick was a great pickup. Cox has been playing well. right? The secondary, Slay, is terrific. Right? Losing Gardner Johnson hurts. The linebackers are not very good for the Eagles. I mean, that is a downfall for them. That's what, like, if we're going to talk about San Francisco, for example, San Francisco has a superior defensive line to the Eagles and far superior linebackers. The Eagles have a better secondary. Right? Offensively, offensive lines are pretty close. Running game, pretty close. Tight end, 49ers have the advantage. Wide receivers, the Eagles have the advantage. And quarterback, they have the advantage. Sorry, Brock Purdy's adorable, but that's when it comes to playoff time, you go from Cinderella to adorable. All right? Is that breakdown fair enough for you? You're good.
For the most part, yeah, I agree.
For the most part, what? What are you disputing? That the 49ers have a better defensive line?
I think they're better. Here's why I think it is. They're even.
Do you employ Nick Bosa?
No.
He's the best defensive lineman on the field. Do you employ Armstead? No. Do you employ Fred Warner? No. But the Eagles have a better secondary.
Yes, that is true.
Right? Offensive lines are close. Really close. McGlinchey's really good, by the way, for the 49ers. But overall, 1 through 5, the Eagles' offensive line's a little bit better. Kittle's a better tight end than Goddard. Sorry. It's just a fact, okay? I mean, I have no dog in the hunt, so it's like, I can be more objective than you guys are. I don't care who wins. Okay? You got a better quarterback. You know, getting, what's his name? McCaffrey really helped. But Miles is terrific. And the Eagles have far better wide receivers. Far better. The only problem with playing San Francisco is this. If it worry me if I'm an Eagles fan. What style beat you this year?
No question. Running the ball, control the clock. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, their style beat you this year.
Yeah.
They weren't the ones that did it. But their style is the one that beat you this year. You got a good coach that knows how to play this side. They'll get Deebo Samuel back. But the problem is going to be Purdy's not good enough to win a game against the Eagles. He's just not. That's my opinion. Eagles at home. Purdy'd have to play the greatest game of his life to win. Because you're going to need your quarterback at some point. You're going to. All right. Now, as for Gardner Minshew, you don't have to prepare for two different quarterbacks. You just have to prepare for one. It's not like Minshew does more than Hurts. He doesn't. So you don't have to worry about, now we're going to have to, like, prepare two different ways. No, they're going to run the same pass routes. There's just no quarterback draw. Right? What's the difference? You're already worried about the game.
What, the 49er game? Or this game
on
Saturday?
No, Cowboys game.
Not as much anymore because, I mean, I'm not expecting Jalen Hurts to play, even despite what the reports are out today. And I know if he doesn't play, the Eagles don't have a greatest shot to win. They only need to win one more game to clinch everything. So I'm actually all right.
He is the toughest, I'll tell you right now.
Oh, yeah.
I always respected Jalen Hurts as a leader off the field. And I'll tell you where my great respect for him in college came. Was when he lost the job, right? And Tua comes in, does his deal, and Hurts is supporting him every step of the way. And I thought, what a great teammate. And then when they needed him in the SEC championship game, he stepped. Remember me talking about that game? I said, my respect for him went off the charts because he stepped in and he played like he was the starter.
Absolutely.
Right. Then he went to Oklahoma. I got to give him credit. When he was at Oklahoma with Lincoln Riley, he improved his accuracy. And now, that throw he made on the sideline to Devontae Smith against the Bears.
Oh, yeah, it was his best throw of the day, no question.
What? I mean, you got to be kidding me. I don't think anybody else in the league makes that throw. I really don't. And one final, no, because he's the MVP. Hurts is the MVP of the league, which I think is pretty much, as you know, I think is an irrelevant award. Because I think all MVPs are irrelevant. To me, it's about teams winning. It's not about whether you're the MVP of the league. And I vote for this stuff. I do vote for it. But Hurts is special on the field. He is special in the locker room. They carry his attitude, and he is special to the general manager because the general manager is saying, my quarterback's on a second-round contract, and yours isn't. Let's party. And Eagles fans, stop acting like little brother. You're the better team.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
So did you foul up again? Is that what you're telling me on the text?
It's more a computer system than anything else.
All right, so it's you. All right, so... All right. We'll have Neil Coulong next half hour. Did you see who is buying the Phoenix Suns?
I did see that. I can't say I really know a whole lot about him, but I...
Well, guess who announced some of his games in his career?
Ah, okay.
Okay. If you are wondering why Michigan State can pay Mel Tucker $95 million over 10 years, remember how it came about? It was from a prominent Michigan State donor. That prominent Michigan State donor is Matt Ishbia. Matt Ishbia was a walk-on on the 2000 NCAA champion Michigan State basketball team. And yes, he did play a couple of times against Penn State during the course of his career. He has made the Steve Jones basketball chart now, what, 4 years in a row. Matt Ishbia is on there. Actually was on Tom Izzo's staff for a year. Well, his father owns a big company. His father did. And Matt took over the company. And his net worth is $5.1 billion. Okay? That's his net worth. $5.1 billion. And he has now bought the Phoenix Suns for $4 billion. He is the CEO of the Michigan-based United Wholesale Mortgage Group. And he is, as I mentioned, a billionaire beyond words. That's how Mel Tucker's salary is paid at Michigan State. Ishbia was able to get it done. I think get help from some other people. This is the second largest sale in the history of North American franchise sports. Second largest. After the Walton, bought the Denver Broncos for $4.6 billion. And, of course, Walton means that's Walmart money. $4.6 billion. So Ishbia now buys the Suns today for $4 billion. I remember when Steve Ballmer bought the L.A. Clippers, and I'll be literally staying across the plaza from where the Clippers play, at least where they currently play. They're gonna get a new arena out by where the Rams play in Inglewood. I remember when Steve Ballmer bought the Clippers, when everything went off the rails there, and he bought them for $2 billion. I thought, holy mackerel, did he overpay? Wow, $2 billion. It's not the Lakers, it's the Clippers. And now, as each day goes by, the $2 billion looks like it was a bargain. Like Ballmer was the smartest guy in the room. Because Ballmer was going to buy the Sacramento Kings and moved into Seattle. And they fell through. Kevin Johnson, the former Phoenix Suns guard, became the mayor of Sacramento. He negotiated, and they built a new arena, Globe One, which is supposedly spectacular. I've never seen it or been to it. And the Kings stayed in Sacramento. So Ballmer then bought the Clippers. Now listen to the numbers since. Okay? The Walton Penner Group, Walton fronted most of it, $4.6 billion for the Broncos. Matt Ishbia today, $4 billion for the Suns. Steve Cohen bought the Mets for $2.4 billion. Right? Joe Say bought the Brooklyn Nets for $3.35 billion. And David Tepper bought the Carolina Panthers for $2.75 billion. And remember, Tepper was not the highest bidder. But the difference is Tepper had been a part of the Steelers ownership group, and he paid cash. Let that settle in for a moment.
Oh, my almighty!
How did he pay for it? He paid cash. Cash. I think we've got a sale. And Ishbia's net worth is $5.1 billion. And his brother's a part of the United Mortgage Company as well, which is United Wholesale Mortgage. His brother's worth $1 billion. Now, his brother's not involved in this sale, but how about those numbers? Wow. Unreal. $4 billion for the Suns. And it's worth it to the NBA. They want to get Sarver out, and they're going to do it. Now, the next one is, did you hear about the Carlos Correa story?
Now, this one I didn't.
The Giants were going to introduce Carlos Correa today at a press conference with the, was it, 13-year deal?
Correct.
They have now postponed the press conference because something has come up in the physical. There is a medical concern now with Carlos Correa.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
Whoops. After handing him that mega contract. Uh-oh.
So, sides are awaiting the results of testing, and a medical issue was flagged during Correa's physical. So, the question is whether they're like him staying, and if he does stay, do they have to renegotiate the deal based on this? Who knows? But that happened this afternoon. Amazing. Kenny Pickett expected to start for the Steelers against the Raiders, the 50th anniversary of the Immaculate Reception game. The actual 50th anniversary is Friday. The game is Saturday on Christmas Eve. Jalen Hurts says, quote, definitely a chance to play against the Cowboys. I wouldn't put it past him at all. Would you? No.
No. Yeah.
This guy wants to play. I mean, I can understand completely why Eagles fans love this guy. He just works, and then he plays. Okay? That's going to depend on, you know, what they think. But this, I mentioned Kenny Pickett. I bring that up because Kenny Pickett, this is an interesting time for the Steelers. The NFL goes in cycles because of the way the league is designed. And the Steelers for years, along with the Patriots and the Packers, have kind of defied that for almost 20 years. They've always, for the most part, been relevant. Fair? At least they've been relevant. They, you know, they may not be champions. You know, I mean, the Steelers won twice, the Packers won once, but they've always been in the playoffs, made runs in the playoffs, things like that. Patriots, of course, won six times.
Yep, fair.
Lost three Super Bowls. Right, so they were always within the neighborhood of winning a division championship, and then it just depended on luck of the draw, whatever it may be. You know, in terms of not getting there. I mean, the Eagles are a perfect example of that. The Eagles have been the best team in the NFC East in this century. Now, they haven't won the most Super Bowls this century from the division. The Giants have. They've won two. The Eagles have won one. But the Eagles have been the better franchise this century because the Giants won the two, but they have not been relevant since. Fair?
Definitely.
Right. So think of all the NFC Championship games that the Eagles have been to. How many they've been to this century? Five, six? Six NFC title games?
Yeah, six now. Yeah, five with Andy Reid and then 2017. Yeah.
Right. And to me, the only one of the ones that they lost that I thought they should have won was the one to Tampa. The year Tampa won the Super Bowl, I still to this day maintain the Eagles were the better team. And they're playing at home, and they just kind of fouled it up that day. They just didn't play well. And, you know, Tampa, until they got Brady, weren't relevant after that. So the Eagles, for a period of time with Andy, defied this, but then after that they kind of fell off the radar, fell off the map, and then they got into the cycle of, okay, schedule, drafting, right? Howie's made great, like I mentioned, Howie outmaneuvered the Giants, got Devontae Smith. He made the pick of Hurts, you know, not knowing he was going to get this. And now they've got all these drafts. The Eagles are in a great spot. Now, the Steelers, for the first time, are really in this spot because, for the most part, the Steelers have been drafting 20 to 32, you know, over the last 20 years. Now, once in a while, you know, they made a trade. They traded for Devin Bush, 10th overall pick, and that wasn't a good deal. But now they're going to have their rookie quarterback, albeit first-round money, but still a rookie quarterback deal with Pickett for the next 3 years beyond this. This is where they have to make some hay in rebuilding the team. That's what they need. The Eagles, Carson Wentz is going to be the gift that keeps on giving because of the draft picks they got out of that. And the Eagles now do not have to pick a quarterback with the high draft pick they have. How about that? I mean, think about that. How lucky do you have to get with that?
Yes.
I mean, they don't. When they got the draft pick, the idea was, okay, let's just see how Hurts does. All right, maybe we should bet draft. No, now they don't have to. Now they can go out and improve the football team. Goody. Because the quarterback. Now, the window to win championships becomes a dicey one once it comes time to pay Hurts. Because and there's going to be a point where they're going to have to pay Jalen Hurts. That's not going to be this year or next year. But at some point they'll have to, which will then have to change what their financial flexibility is. But if I were Eagles fans, enjoy your next 3 years. You have a chance to be the best team in the NFL for 3 years. You know, as long as you can get through the attrition part. The attrition part's a big part. I tried to point out, for some reason, Mike didn't understand I was talking about attrition in 17 games. He didn't quite get that yesterday. Right? That had nothing to do with the Eagles. It had to do with everybody. Why are the Ravens struggling right now? How many guys do they have out?
Yeah, it's not just Lamar Jackson. It's a lot of people.
How many guys do the Rams have out?
Yeah.
I mean, you start going through all these teams that aren't doing well. How many guys do they all have out? Because this was always, I remember I was gung-ho about, hey, go to 18 games. Come on, it's great. We want to see more football. And then I'm watching, and that goes back, I made that comment maybe 10 years ago, that I'm watching all these 16-game seasons, and we kept getting to, like, this time of the year, and you're like, well, this guy's out, that guy's out, and this guy's out, and that guy's out. Like, man, because it's such a physical sport, you get beat up. You got to be lucky to get through relatively unscathed. The Eagles are lucky that they lose Goddard and they have such a good supporting cast, right? They can get by it and you don't even think about it. So now you're getting him back. They've had such a good secondary that Johnson goes out, but they've been able to weather it. They got enough guys. They're fine. They have not had wholesale losses. Remember last year when they lost Lane Johnson?
Yeah, that was a tough one.
Right. I mean, and all of a sudden you're like, oh, suddenly that great offensive line's not so great. And then when they got to the playoffs, they got buried. And because attrition took a toll on the Eagles last season. And that's the problem with everybody in this league with 17 games. I remember last year was the first year they went through it. And when they got to like week 15, you're like, God, there's still 3 games left.
I was never for this idea of more regular season games. Yeah, never was.
It's going to go to 18.
Oh, I know. Oh, yeah. I know it's inevitable, but yeah, I just. This is going to be more of a problem when we get to 18 regular season games than it is now with 17.
And one of the biggest problems you're going to have is that the Cooper Rushes and Gardner Minshews of the game are going to be playing some of these games. Right? And that's not what people want to watch. They want to watch Dak Prescott and Jalen Hurts. I mean, the quarterback position is thin enough. Kyler Murray's now out for the year. Colt McCoy's hurt. It might be Trace McSorley this week. Yeah? We're watching Baker Mayfield last night. Really? And you know what? What's interesting about last night's game? Do you realize this? Last night the Packers won 24-12. Right? They won by 12 points. Correct? That was the largest margin of victory in the NFL this weekend.
That's right. It was almost it was tied for the record for most games that finished under 5 points margin of victory or something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that's remarkable. Ooh, Matt Carpenter left the Yankees.
It's all right. Have fun in San Diego. Thanks, but have fun in San Diego.
Excuse me, you were jumping up and down with your Yankee pom-poms every time you got a hit in May and June. Now he's garbage to you?
Not garbage, just it kind of... The magic ran out. How about that?
You can't go on the show and say you're dead to me. You can't do that stuff. Come on. Come on. This is what you're teaching your kids? Come on. You're getting scary. If the Eagles were to lose in the playoffs, and it's a big if, because let's face it, they are the best team. But even the best team can have a bad day. That's what you're going to be scared of. I mean, they're the best team. They're better. They're better than the Bills. They're better than the Chiefs. They're better than the 49ers. The problem is, like, if, like, say they play the same game against those teams that they played against the Bears on Sunday, they're not going to win.
Correct.
Okay, that's the issue. You do have to be good every time out, not just good enough. You got to, you know, when you get to the playoffs, you got to be good. But I'm worried for you if it doesn't go well one day. I'm scared.
It would definitely be one of the more massive disappointments in franchise history.
No, I'm talking about your disappointment.
Oh, well, that goes without saying.
Talking about you. Lisa and I standing at the bottom. Matt, you think of little Luke and little Mark. Come down. Matt, it's okay. It's just a game. That's right. We already had that speech with the Yankees, didn't we?
Yeah, we did.
Matt, if you can't laugh, you gotta be able to laugh at stuff. Okay. Look at my teams. The Red Sox this year were lousy. How am I?
You are Mr. 45 heart rate.
The Giants are between mediocre and good. How am I?
Perfectly fine.
The Celtics lost in the finals.
Once again.
It's okay. I'm going to sit down today and watch the famous Idaho Potato Bowl and enjoy it. I enjoy sports more than ever now. I just enjoy watching games. How close have you ever come to breaking a TV? Oh, he has to think about it.
When car repairs get difficult.
Well, I just don't know.
Me neither.
We get good. Sunbury Motors. More than quality new and used cars, Sunbury Motors specializes in complicated auto repair diagnosis. They can handle intricate repairs and even complete auto body with service open Monday through Friday, 7 till 4. And Sunbury Motors has made simple repairs easy. Maintaining your vehicle is necessary. Finding the time to do it is difficult. Welcome to Sunbury Motors Quick Lane. Open 7 till 4, Monday through Friday. Just walk in or call ahead. Relax in their remodeled waiting room with Wi-Fi, beverages, and snacks. Will Sunbury Motors factory trained techs take care of your oil change, tire alignments, brakes, and inspections. Quick Lane, 6:30 to 6, Monday through Friday, Saturday, 6:30 till 2. Sunbury Motors, Ford and Hyundai, North 4th Street, Sunbury. And Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. We take the out of auto repair.